Motherfuckers! Everyone is starting to be with motherfuckers! You're a bunch of motherfuckers! Mostly because either you fuck somebody that will be a mother, or you're fucking a mother that might become a mother. Motherfuckers, and most of you are men, but some of you are women, and so some of you women are also lesbian, and you're fucking mothers and motherfuckers. Or some of you are just getting fucked and you're a motherfucker. Anyway, the point. Okay, drunk video. Why? Okay, a few things, kind of just to, you know, give you guys a little heads up about what's going on. I have been dieting and working out like a goddamn mofo. Mofo meaning what, motherfucker? I've been dieting, isagenix, son of a bitch, this shit, right? See that? See that? Go to isagenix or isamovie.com, right? Like I'm on Facebook, and this lady who I met at the white party, right? Now, if you haven't gone to a white party, you got to look up white parties. White parties are amazing. And this isn't a racist thing. This is just you wear white, right? Any culture, anything, you can go to a white party. But the point is, white parties were big here in Utah. Go Utah, right? And the funny thing about Utah is that the entirety of Mormon culture on humanity is fucking extreme, right? It's amazing. Even the television, right, is arguably, but only a very minimal argument, invented by some guy that was Mormon. Not that being Mormon caused him to do that, but you can't separate the thing. Now, I'm not Mormon, right? But I read the dialogue. I grew up around him. All I know is a very impressive, influential culture that tries to press itself outward. And this kind of is precedence to making a video tonight. Why? Well, okay, so I've been working out a lot, right? And then I got this farmer's market art, right? I'm still art. You guys know I do art. Let me show you guys this, if I can, just for the hell of it, before my battery runs out entirely. Tinder, by the way, I've been joining Tinder. What? Tinder? That's supposed to be a hookup site. Well, in Utah, most 90% of them, I'm not here to hook up. Right, and which is fine, you know. I'm looking for a serious relationship, not a hookup. But a hookup would, you know, probably clean the pipes out. Anyway, point is I, you know, there's me with isagenix, right? Big thing. Now, if you're in Europe, sorry, it's an Australian, American, Canadian, New Zealand, China, Mexico thing. But it doesn't matter. All I know is I've been on it for 2.5 weeks. I've lost about 16 pounds. And what was the inspiration for this? Well, number one, I wasn't getting any dates. Number two, I was a smoking, depressive, like, liberal, suck-it-up motherfucker. And number three, I didn't give a shit. And I just kind of, you know, since 2010 till now, I fucking put on a lot of weight. So I decided, hey, I'm done putting on weight. Even though tonight is an exception, you break the rules, right? You set the rules, you follow the rules, then you break the rules, and then you get back on the rules. So there's rules to isagenix about how you eat and what you eat and all this other shit. Now, isagenix is just like clean out your system sort of system. Clean out your system, de-cleanse, build muscle, and then it's also a network marketing company, right? So if you want to join, you just get a hold of me and I'll show you what's up. Oh, let me just, okay. Fuck it, whatever, man. See that? Singletreasure.com. That's also where I'm doing my pitches for isagenix, and I'm showing my 30-day cleanse process. Okay, now, the reason I'm making a video, pardon me, the reason everything led into this, right, was that I was dieting and I'm getting ready for these farmers markets. So I'm cranking out a painting, but I'm more worried about prints and getting my stand set up and all this other shit, right? And I am getting in shape. I've lost all this weight. My belly fat's down. I'm fucking, I'm doing more laps. I'm not eating as much. I'm a goddamn lean, mean swimming machine. And I don't know, like, somehow the pressure of the farmer's market coming up and just, you know, it's Saturday and today it's going on to Thursday. And then I got on Tinder, right? It's like, I got a date. I got a fucking date, man. I'm not dating. I'm not meeting anyone. I'm not talking to anyone. I don't think anyone can relate to who it is I am or what it is I'm doing or blah, blah, blah. And I'm stronger and I'm thinner and I'm more confident. And I'm just more fluid. And these I tell you, they're called natural essentials. And I'm not trying to pitch you guys. I'm really not. But this is a vitamin pack, right? AM and PM, AM and PM. So in the morning you take an AM, and in the evening you take a PM, and I guess the difference is like melatonin or something. But look at how many supplements are just there. And then there's these other supplements. Okay, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, enough about that. If you want to know more, go to my other channel, Single Treasure, singletreasure.com. You'll see me pitching it, building my team, because that's what I'm doing. Because the wave of the economic future is not lateral go work for a living. It is network marketing building on top of a hierarchy. And it just seems to be the capitalistic method and the capitalistic way. And so be it. Okay, that being said, I decided that I was nervous. I haven't been nervous in a while, but I've got a project, which means do the farmer's market, and I was a little nervous to go to the farmer's market, but I was on Tinder, right? And I was listening to Meridian Frost on Facebook actually talk about Tinder, saying, this is just a hookup site. It's a hookup site, and I kind of regret blah, blah, blah being involved or something like that, and he kind of deferred it. And my brother was like, hey man, I can't fucking believe you. I'm trapped and I got a marriage and I'm hanging out in the marriage and I got a kid and blah, blah, blah. And I could only wish to be single like you because you could be dating and fucking whoever and blah, 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 blah. So just get goddamn go out and do something, you know, live vicariously. I'm living vicariously through you and you're doing nothing, but do something. Just fucking help yourself get a relationship, blah, blah, blah. And I'll be goddamned if everything, like I just haven't met an actual pragmatic, real, in-person relationship that is functional in a long time. I know. I fucked up things in 2008, but that was 2008, those 7 years ago. So, all this being said, here I am. So I decide I'm going to get on Tinder. And in Utah, maybe different than other lines, 90% of the women write, I'm not here to hook up. Right? Okay, now, and that's fine. Do I look thinner, by the way? I'm looking downwards. You guys are seeing my chin. Don't I look like Gray Tex a little bit? Just kidding. Kidding, Gray Tex. I know you've thinned out. You turned out. And it was just weird to get fat and then thin, or thin and then fat and then thin, or whatever. All I know is, see that shit? Straight. I can see my dick again when I pee, right? Very little muscle. I mean, very little fat. Still working on it. Okay. But I'm still a goddamn country boy with my plaid on and Coast Rica. Okay. So, I decided I'm going to start going on dates. So, I go on a date and I'm getting catfish. Now, if you don't know what catfish means, that means that the women or the men, but mostly women, do not look or portray themselves as they actually appear on their profile. Right, they're either putting up old photos or they're just bullshitting you. Anyway, all of a sudden I find this woman and she's got full body shots and everything. It's really kinker, and we're chatting back and forth. And the thing about her is that she is a goof. She's a goofball. She's funny. She's weird but goofy, right? And I'm like, I kind of like her. So I'm homing in on her and I'm trying to narrow this date. But anyway, I'm frustrated with my prints and getting ready, and all I know is damn it, I want to go get some wine. So I have been buying this wine lately at recommendation Marusu of a bartender at one of my local Irish pubs. And because I'm winey instead of beery, except for tonight, I'm beery, which is calorie, but it's light, right? So I'm saving on calories. Anyway, So I take her advice and I buy this wine, and it's excellent. Like, it's a cab. It's like 11, 12 bucks locally here in Utah. I don't even know where it's made. All I know is it's such the right balance between acid and alcohol and sweetness, but there's just this like weird perfect balance. And I tried it at the bar, and she turned me on to it, and it's been great. So in the last 14 days, I've gone on a total of two and a half benders, tonight being the half bender. And I'm pushing it, right? And the reason I wanted to make this video, right? I don't make a lot of videos anymore because what the fuck? What the fuck is this shit? This sheep shit, right? My channel is sheep shit. It's been like bartering or catering to this antinatalist philosophy and like, either I'm anti Mr. Anton or I'm anti Gary Moser or I'm just anti, right? I'm just going to be anti shit. But even though I like move in and walk in and walk out and it's boundary oriented, I went to this cool little place called Squatters in Salt Lake, which is one of the high end brewery restaurants that a lot of tourists go to. After I got stood up on a Tinder date 2 nights ago, and then tonight I'm gonna go there again. I just am, and it, like in a year and a half, I've been there twice, and that's been within a 3-day period. So I sit down next to this woman who is waiting for another woman, and then the other woman shows up, and they have their conversation, and you know, not a lot or any engagement there, and it didn't matter. But anyway, there was an open seat next to me, and this guy from Chicago sits down, and Chris. Keep his last name under wraps, just in case you guys want to fucking stalk him. I'll kill you. Don't stalk anybody. I'll kill you. So, sorry, that was meant to be funny. No, I know it's nice. Let me bounce it out with a little drink of you. Anyway, he programs in Perl, the computer language, and he makes shopping APIs. Like shopping carts and shopping apps, at stuff to compete with Stripe and Square. And it's a small business out of Chicago. And he came to Salt Lake because there was a big Perl meeting. And anyway, we got to discussing shit. And we kept drinking. And he ate. And I'm on a fast today, right? A cleanse. Not a fast. Fast is pretty religious. Cleanse just means fucking clearing out your system, brother. What involves in a cleanse? Not only these vitamins, but snacks. You get to eat some snacks. They're actually called isagenix snacks. As if I'm promoting this shit, right? But the funny thing is, I call them Scooby snacks. And they're like little pieces, little pellet, little dog food things. You eat like 4 of them a day. Weird, right? So I've been on that as part of what you do 4 or more times per any 30-day cycle. The rest of the time you're drinking shakes. Blah, blah. Okay, so he and I are talking, and I get to go showing him clowncash.com, which is still up, clowncash.com. It's only up for maybe, 6 more months, right? Because I'm saying, hey, man, I needed a shopping cart API that was different than PayPal, that wasn't going to charge me a shitload, that I can implement through the guys in India, through Elance, that helped me build this fucking thing for several $1,000s, which ran into nothing, right? Ran into nothing. And I needed something a little more convenient, and maybe he could help me. And he saw it, and he's like, oh my God, that's just crazy. And then I showed him my art, right? And I just got on Instagram. Mike Fail Art. M-I-K-E, Mike Fail, F-A-H-L, Art, A-R-T, Mike Fail Art on Instagram. Check me out, sign up, follow me. Wonder if this video is going to crash, who knows. It's good ranting anyway. Even if it fails. Look at my dark meat.
Look at that dark Iranian meat under my eyes.
I don't even know where that comes from genetically. Mom's got it. I think it's Chickasaw, right? Supposedly I'm 132nd Chickasaw Indian, and that's where I got my dark meat in my grip. Okay, anyway. Side 10. Okay, so there's Chris, Pearl, talking. We talk computers for a while. We talk this. We just look at clown cash. Then we get talking about weird shit, right? I start talking about, okay, let me tell you about the orb, the four things that I have seen that are supernatural, and yet two of them, I think, could be talked about in terms of physics, right? Now, okay, now this all might seem a little weird, but, and I'm not going to link you to it, why can't I remember her name? You guys know who I'm talking about. Floria. She's an antinatalist, right? She's from Australia, yet she's like East Indian. From Australia. Floria. Let's just call her Floria. She got on a hangout recently that I watched, and she was talking with this other guy, right, kind of about supernatural metaphysical shit, and he was talking about angels. I think it was angels. And she started talking about something unexplainable in her childhood, right? And so anyway, I got on this thing about orbs and ghosts and Jacob's ladders and this big red goddamn googly thing I saw in the sky and certain associations with it. And then this guy from Chicago started chiming in and saying, "Hey, man, I thought my brother was under the couch pulling me in, and it was a scary, like, demon thing under the couch pulling me in. And then when I went and I got up and I went into the kitchen, and there was my brother with my mom, and we were the only three in the house. And then I went back, and there was nothing under the couch, and it totally freaked me out. And my brother experienced poundings on the door, and he saw somebody in my bed, and then turned on the light, and they weren't in my bed, and he started talking about his supernatural experience." So I'm thinking, Floria, and this guy, and even fucking Gary talks about some childhood event, something that is extracurricular to the physical world, right? Now, if you go online, and you guys have been online, you've seen this, I hope you've seen this, and if you haven't, look up non-dualism, look up spiritual teachers, look up Tan Swill or Matt Kahn or, oh shit, I just forget the names. But anyway, there's bundles of non-dualists or non-dualist teachers or philosophers or even Matt who talks about panpsychism and Alfred North Whitehead. And there's Anton and all these other people expanding our minds in weird ways, right? And then you get the collusive kind of narrow band of atheist pragmatics, you know, and I pin Gary's a natural physicist. Anyway, so, blah, blah, you got all these different perspectives, all these different things, right? Now, I'm a supernaturalist, and I'm a panpsychist, in that everything is alive and that everything at a Planck's length in data is energy, and that that energy feeds outward and inward. And unlike our minds being but an antenna for the outside universe to fit in, the hard problem of consciousness is found and solved in my mind, right, currently, presently, concurrently, with the idea or the notion, the metaphor, that our brain functions as a prism. And by prism, I mean that all data, infinitely outward, like gravity, we're pulling on every star and every star is pulling on us, and even though at light speed things are moving farther away from us, the gravity, whether it's caught up with us or not, is supposedly infinite at a Planck's length, right? And he had just recently heard Stephen Hawking speak, Or wait, it was another physicist speak about Stephen Hawking, speaking about empty space, right? Like how we live under 15 pressures of atmosphere, right? And we don't notice it because it's just our equilibrium with our atmosphere that we live under 15 pounds. But it's pressure upon us. It's this condensation of pressure, right? And that this is a positive pressure. But in empty space, it's not just zero pressure, it's negative pressure. Negative pressure. But there's a negative pressure of a certain poundage in every ounce of empty space. And this doesn't only just function as terms of pressure, this functions in terms of geometry, right? This solves like this notion of not only black holes, but why empty space pushes, because it's negative, it's separating the parts in the universe, right? It's why we're expanding instead of contracting. It isn't so much the Big Bang as much as it is empty space being so negative that it's actually a negative pressure, and its opposite is a type of spatial expansion. I'm not certain quite how that works, but I was listening to a lecture on that and thought it quite fascinating. And when I thought about that negative, you know, black space, black matter, dark matter is not just empty. It's not just benign in some sort of, it's actually negative. It's pulling and pushing, right, in its own particular way, opposite of pressure. So I thought that this peculiar. Okay, so
like Benjamin Franklin says, thank God for beer.
No, he didn't say that. He said something much more subtle and eloquent.
Like, beer is the reason why we're happy.
All right, anyway, I'm 22 minutes, still rambling on. By the way, if you guys want to know an update on my physiology, my pain in my feet is so lesson. It's so small now. It's just incredible. Okay, that's done. Okay. So anyway, so I'm talking about this blank space. We're talking about Planck's length outward to everything that a gravitational pull has on you. Photons run through space, but they're not running through an ether, but they are running through a geometric pressure collapse, a negative. And somehow they still exist. Right, so and so it's arguably not necessarily an ether as much as it is just a mathematical negation as opposed to the positive pressure of an atmosphere, such as around planets or gravitational forces. Very, very interesting, I thought. Okay. Now this guy Chris at the bar, he's from Chicago and he runs with Pearl and he does these gateways and we get to talking about Clan Cash and other things. And then we start talking about the weird shit and the supernatural shit, and then he told me his story after I told him my stories, and he thought it was very interesting. And then somehow, when I was driving back, right, because you know me, I like to drive while I'm really shitty. Not really. I had water. Sober dash. But then I went to the store. Got some of this. Just re-peek it. Sure, some of you can relate. It dawned on me that this whole, trick, whatever his numbers are, right? Who knows who gets a fuck? Trick, everybody knows Trick is the commentator. Right, apparently he's some Eastern American, I like that phrase, right? Eastern American, meaning he's from back east, he's got a little bit of an accent, maybe the Midwest, who knows? It's not coming to mind. Anyway, he finally decides he wants to do these communal dialogues, and he thinks that he can't speak well, even though he does. His oratory skills are just fine, especially on a one-on-one. Anyway, so he argues with Birdman, Falcon Man, Vic, right? And I get to commenting in his videos. It's like his second, maybe first chat, I don't know. And I bring up how this whole value equation shit, right, that anti-natalists lay down, value equation, right? Just think about value ethics, right? where your neuronal firing, by itself, proper your neuronal firing, is where value lies, right? If you, as a sentient being, a conscious being, feel something, that is the value, right? And then, so what I do is I comment on Trick, right? Because I've been through extreme bone-crushing pain, I've been through chronic stomach pain, I've been through all sorts of these dynamics, I even give myself pain in the masochistic way. And the weird thing about masochism is that when you experience, like, tremendous bone-crushing pain, you know, burning a cigarette out in your hand, it's fucking nothing. It's nothing. It's a goddamn cakewalk. So why is it that to some people that would be huge and to other people it wouldn't? And I got to thinking once again about the idea of, okay, when you have an infant, right, not that I have any kids, but if I had a kid, right, and I was a kid, and I've held kids, and you hug the kid, and you're a man, right, and you rub a little bit of beard on the baby's cheek, where you're like, oh, little baby, right? The baby will probably start crying. It's agitated by a little bit of beard fuzz, right? But take that baby, expand it 18 years. It's an 18-year-old female baby, and it's having sex with a man, boy man, with some beard scruff, and they're going at it, and his beard rubs against her cheek, right? She's not crying anymore, right? It's the same neuronal firing, right? A cheek rubbing up against the beard. Same sensation, supposedly, which I can call it that, equated as such. And yet, she's not crying. As a matter of fact, it's a turn-on, right? It's kind of like burning a cigarette. It's kind of like a masochism, maybe. Or maybe kind of like my relationship to bone-crushing too. Cigarette burning to something, right? It's an evolution of the same data, same neuronal firing, different reaction. So what has happened over that time, that temporal expansion, right? What has happened? That's the question. Because Trick says, I say, hey, When I'm in pain, I feel the pain, but immediately I'm noting what type of pain, what's its texture, what's its content, how is it, right? I note this. Now what Trick's response to me is, and where we have a difference is, he says, the sensation is the valuation, or is the value. What you're doing by noticing the texture or the type is valuation. Your valuation of the value. You're not homing in on the value. And he notes that I seem to make either a distinction or similarity there, where he makes a distinction, or he makes a distinction and I make a similarity. Right. It's kind of like Gary. Gary will say, bad is bad. Whether or not I'm feeling pain or that squid over there is feeling pain, it is pain, hence is bad, 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 bad. Whether it's public, whether it's private, whether it's internal, whether it's, we just know it is pain. That's the ethic, right? That's the idea. But what I'm telling Trick, and so Trick tries to retain this dichotomous division, right, between what you sense and how you view what you sense are two different things. And the reason I am making this video, this almost 30-minute video, is just a drink in front of you, really. Man. I swear to God, it's just to have a drink. How are you guys doing? How are all you doing? Yeah, I love y'all. You've been great to me. I mean, even though I lost like 3 subscribers last week and I'm now from 750 down to like 748, am I ever going to get back to 750? I mean, after 7, 8, 10 years on YouTube, can I break 1,000, please? Anyway, my point is this. By evaluating, according to Trick, I'm evaluating or valuating the value by noting what texture, I call it texture, what type, what kind of sensation am I feeling, right? By noting it and typifying it, kinding it, putting in the kind, classifying it, and then dissolving classification, but just noting it somewhere in this palette of what we would call negative or pain, right? Now, the point is, for Trick, is that it's negative, right? You're negative. But my point is that the valuation of the value, the reconsideration, the thinking about it, not only are you placing it somewhere otherly than just allowing the direct current to hit you, the act, the very, very act, Trick, and any other antinatalist out there, the act of noting, sensing, reapproaching, reconsidering, reing, looking at the value, what you call the neuronal firing that is what it is, right? The act of looking at it changes the value. It changes it. It doesn't remain the same. It's like quantum mechanics. As soon as an observer observes it, it functions differently than if an observer wasn't observing. So you feel the pain. Then when you observe the pain, it changes the quality of the sensation. All of a sudden, the pain can become something like a benign firing, a sensation. I'm not going so far as to say, you know, pain isn't negative, because that's kind of what we're getting at with suffering and pain. At the same time, when you note the quality or the texture of a sensation, and I accuse antinatalists of not delving into this very phenomenal fact of not only sentient beings, but human and other sensual beings, right? There is a point, and I say this from experience, right? When you have chronic, bone-crushing fucking pain, and you cannot think your way out of it, you cannot do anything, medicine doesn't cover it, nothing covers it, nothing covers it, right? You could chop your head off, maybe, right, to get away from it. But then you'd have whatever that is. But anyway, you can do whatever is possible now and still not get away from chronic pain. And then what happens? Okay. Let me just reiterate that point. Valuation of value changes the value. Period. Okay, let me get that point across. I state that not only as a claim, but as a refutation of this notion of what suffering is. The isness of suffering. This is what suffering, we can't have life or procreation because we're making life because of suffering. Right? But like if you watch videos of a gazelle being eaten by a lion, at one point, kind of like my chronic pain, where you can't get rid of it, the gazelle is mounged, and it fights, and then it stops fighting. Then it accepts. It accepts, right? You accept. Once you're past this plateau of accepting pain, right? Here's this other idea, right? Like Vic was talking about a dial, right? Like pain is like a dial, like a volume dial, and you can turn it up. True, true. Now, is there such a thing as maximum pain, right, where your brain, your being, your prism could not possibly accept any more data from the neurons saying this is in pain? And I say, yes, there's obviously a top threshold, right? And some people have only experienced minor little scruffies, and some people got little boo-boos, and some people blah, 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 and some people even get cancer, and they die, and they're like, it's an asphyxiation, like drowning, right? Maybe, who knows? Like, we know, because it's fucking awful. My point is, is even in chronic pain, you are not living a life always noting, denoting, and living in chronic pain. Okay, but now where was I going? I hope I don't lose it all again. Let me drink a little and see if I can get it back. Keystone, the key. Okay, so I think I lost it, but it was evaluation, right? Evaluation trumps value, it curves it, it changes it, like quantum mechanics, and then, so this notion of pain and value and suffering needs to be not only reinvestigated, but like fleshed out with possible lingual dynamic. Now, okay, you get like Rorschach, right? And he's like, he's just more like categorical, like, hey man, I don't like people talking anti-life when they have no substantive, you know, coherence to speak about value in a non-life. I'm not trying to sum up his arguments by any means. As a matter of fact, I think that the angle is absolutely positive. And Grant, I've looked at myself personally. I have no kids, right? I have no kids. So functionally, ontologically, I'm an antinatalist, right? Well, I mean, I'm not a natalist, so I'm not an antinatalist, but I'm just a non-natalist, right? Okay, but where was it going? Value changes. Okay, so the act of observing value changes the value, right? And I've been trying to get this across, but I don't think that people want to accept this premise, right? Now, I'm not saying that if you observe pain that you're going to be out of pain, but when you observe pain and then you think about baseball, at that moment that you're thinking about baseball, the pain is not a data set that is in the consciousness. The baseball is in the consciousness. And that becomes what is focal, right? So this is a kind of a displacement sort of fight club. Don't burn, don't think, don't miss this important time of your life. Just burn, 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 burn. Okay, and I got my fight club burn. See that scar? See that scar? But you're right there. Yeah. Okay. So I'm not really trying to demonstrate myself as a masochist, you know, even though I've gone through that, right? My point is, okay, here's a side note as I'm trying to think about where I was going. So like Flyora starts complaining, like, I don't like to get up in the morning to go to work, or I don't want to do, you know, it's this whole like consent to want to do something that the organism just, I don't want to do it, right? And so I critique the idea of consent, just in general, consent. Like, look, granted, I'm not going to disagree that we are a bounded by skin organism. You know, I'm not saying that we're not more than that, that we're not super, we're not amazing in some, like, cubed, solipsistic, outwardly, God loves us, we're pawns in the universe, and this is all a matrix game that we're subject to. I'm not saying we're not that. All I'm saying is that we also are these skin-bound, muscle-bound creatures, right? I better plug in my computer. So anyway, that being said, damn, I hope I don't just turn this into a shit video by losing all my trains of thought. Computer's on. Okay. Where's it go? Well, it kind of led to this. Okay, so anyway, the funny thing was, is like, Flora, like, I don't want to get up. I don't want, like, this, like, weird, like, adolescent kind of juvenile baby one. Like, she's somewhere between the baby and the adult with regards to rubbing, right, the beard scrub, right? And I suggest, number one, this is an angel academy. We're on Earth, and we're angels, and we're trying to angelify ourselves, whatever. And we have to go through this process. Anyway, and that, you know, you can be religious and go with the flow, or you can be spiritual by going to hell first and then coming out of hell. And I chose the second. But, okay, so
my point is that when you, if hypothetically, right, like antinatalists like to say, like it's a binary value that you pain or pleasure, and that pleasure is only derived from the lack of pain, right? So my suggestion, kind of like if you take a slingshot, right, and you pull it back 2 inches and you let go, the pebble is going to drop within a yard of you, right? But if you take that fucker and you yank it all the way back, you know, as far as you got them, and you let it go, boom, that fucker will fly, you know, 800, 900 yards, et cetera, et cetera. And the same thing, like, okay, if you, in fact, are stuck on a binary of pain and pleasure, if, in fact, pleasure is only the lack of pain, then, to me, in my experience, to serve you better in terms of enlightenment, in my experience, in the social enlightenment, to get out of the pessimism, the dogmatism, the reiteration of what is bad in terms of value of life, or this reiteration of suffering in this kind of bullshit, non-empathetic, reiterative way that antinatalists say, oh, you know, there's pain, but they're really referring to their periphery of what they empathize with, right? They don't really give a fuck what they say. They give a fuck about what everything else. My point is if that is the case, then, and according to my experience, if you drop yourself into a complete and utter devastation of pain that you cannot escape, that upon the rebound, the healing, the increase, the et cetera, the escape from the pain, you will actually escalate into something beyond your notions of what is pleasurable. Beyond orgasm, beyond, you will take the entirety of your being, if you decimate it, you know, without killing yourself, if you decimate it and harm yourself, then the rebound, the object, the separate, the opposite, the polar opposite, the pulling the slingshot all the way back, boom, you will throw yourself into what I think is a complete tank of spiritual enlightenment. Because you'll have taken all of your sensual pleasures and you'll have denied them because of something catastrophe, and then you will slingshot above everything that you've ever known, and you will collapse everything that you've ever considered or cared about into a singular self that includes you as part of that singular self. In all solipsistic notions of who it is you might be, and you will become aware of just what I've been speaking of, that at a plank's length, infinitely outward, you are connected to everybody and everything, and hence, even this technology, even this communication that I feel like on a drunken night, like, I gotta convince myself of some sort of pragmatism, right? Now, and this leads on a little bit into some weirdness, right? You will fall into solipsism and self-godhood, goddesshood. You will fall into this with an understanding of vibrational force and everything, vibrational force, and everything that these supposed enlightened fuckers are talking about on tubes, right? You will fall into that. You will understand it. You will engage it. You won't be bewildered by it anymore. You will lose your atheism because, granted, there's more not understood than there is understood. Infinitely. There's more ignorance infinitely outward than there ever is knowledge inward. So I'm at the bar and I'm hanging out with Chris, right? And he's like, I'm explaining this and we're explaining this, and his default, right, he's a computer engineer, is, hey man, isn't that just like a solipsism? I'm like, no, it's more like a solipsism squared, because the first solipsism, you can't run one hand through the other. I can't run my hand through the table, right? So I'm not a complete God, and that anything can happen, and that if I just think it happens. But then you re-correspond with that idea. You recorrelate it. you reconsider, you reweb it, right? And it remaps of every symbol and every sign and everything that is ever said or spoken to you from other person or media or any signal or sign or color or meaning or feeling is all meant for you, right? In a meaningful, kind of passionate, there's a center to the universe and you are at that center and you are a part of God, an expression of God and not God itself, right? So he's trying to distract him from the notion that he is a expression of God from his sensation that he was God. When you move into solipsism, you get this notion like you own the universe, right? And then you can play in that. But then when you realize the limitations, either the Dharma, the Karma, the Maya, the Brahma, when you start getting into how this works outward, you realize, damn, there are other people. Damn, there are other expressions. Damn, I'm not, even if in a voxel universe, three-dimensional pixel, matrix sort of reality, you guys may be all figments just playing a role against me, but I believe that you're real and I'll interact with you as you're real, even though, spiritually speaking, I know that we're all connected, but we're just different kind of blinded, ignorant incarnations of that and that we can move with one another. So that being said, I better just keep drinking. Son of a bitch. It's not about the alcohol. It's really not. I'll give you a little bit. I think I'll pour it into a glass and make it pretty for everybody. Pour me beer. Pour me light beer.
Pardon me one second, darlings, while I get myself another refill.
A refill? I'm not only British, I'm Transylvanian.
And I come from the Appalachians. Just east of Tennessee. British, Transylvanian, and Appalachian. What a wonderful combo. Alright, so.
What was I getting at? Okay, so. Reconsideration of one's limits as a solipsistic center allow you to expand that. So I said solipsism squared, but then I was thinking solipsistic cubed, right? It's like Dharma and Maya, you can break through that, right? Somehow, somewhere, something, the hard problem of consciousness, why are we here instead of not here? The fact that you are here, the being, your very being, your presence, and I don't give a fuck if you're atheist. I used to be atheist. I used to be fucking hardcore atheist. So fuck you, atheist.
Right? Not really. I love a lot of you. Anyway, my point is this.
Your biological machine, this thing that's all put together in these cells in this way, it, just the fact of its being here, right? Okay, question. Who are you and why are you, right? One defers to the other, right? If you ask why, it means who or what. But if you just maintain the why and the who, why am I here? Who is here? And you analyze every limit and possibility of the who that is here relative to the social, cultural, political confines, relative to the physiological physiology, you're going to find a possible breach and a variance of consideration. If you really get into it, I believe, then what is taught to us, what is the paradigm, the dominant paradigm, the dominant zeitgeist, right? So the mere fact that you are here, you're a goddamn superhero. Right? Superhero movies, everything. Okay, so we're talking, me and Chris. And I say, now look, I grew up in Utah. I wasn't Mormon. Then when I turned 30, I read the Mormon literature. And somewhere between the Book of Mormon and the Doctrine and the Covenants, there was a statement that said everything is real. And I thought, everything is real, right? So that means ignorance is real. That means truth is real. That means knowledge is real. But, right, where do we have a homeostatic notion of knowledge, right? Does that mean superheroes are real? Does that mean the supernatural is real? Does that mean any idea is real? And I thought, everything is real. Everything. And I would rather point the arrows outward than inward. I would rather not make it finite than finite. That's where I'm coming from. It's where I come from. It's what I understand based on my experience now. So the reason I'm damning atheists is because atheism seems to be a lockdown of logical prefaces, right? But logical prefaces is just a type kind of rationality of the mind. It's a type kind, right? It's, you know, we're as platonic and as real as logical and as, you know, constructive in this fashion. But language is more mutable, it's moldable, it extends outward. I'm just saying, I think it does, and I think it moves into not only fiction, but it moves into possibility. Whether it's true now, yeah, do you believe the quantum scientists that say some events in the future can affect events in the past? Just that stretch, that leap that science says is the case, that says is the case, do you buy that? Science says it's so. Do you buy it? Well, it kind of breaches the limit. Even the voxel matrix universe breaches a lot of limits. Like, anybody's theories seem to breach some limit, seem to breach some paradigm, seem to breach something, right? So who do you follow? What do you believe? What are you stuck in? Okay, now what I'm trying to do with this video, sorry I'm taking so long, it's almost now, is to just basically say, I had a great conversation with a guy tonight, and even after all of our supernatural interactions that we talked, he embraced the idea of an internality and kind of a finitude, where I was saying it's both finite and infinite. It's both infinite and finite, right? Finite, sorry. And when it's infinite outward, and that our brains are not just antennas. The hard problem of consciousness means that our consciousness appears from outside data. And I said, what if we are pawns and some AI, otherly alien intelligence, call it God, call it what you will, call it ancient, call it present, call it modern, call it whatever you will, feeds our being? And then what does it mean to negate that? And then what does it mean to believe that you're negating it but still following it? And then what does it mean to believe in purpose or meantness? This universe is meant to be. There is no coincidence. 11-11, blah, blah, blah. Or to say the future is unknown, right? We're just kind of floating through it, right? Which is more of the Gary Mosier, like, hey, you know, it's not a predetermined universe. It's determined, and you have to do the job to make the determinism come about, right? So I'm saying that the limitations of this notion of what a future is are quite limited, and that in fact, let me tell you, like, I know the fact, right? But I'm just saying there's another consideration that is that all that is meant, and kind of the beardy old man, whatever the fuck his old name is, like, it's all already laid out, it's predetermined, but you're not supposed to look at the predeterminism because you can't know it, right? You can't know it. But this brought up the idea of determinism versus free will, right? So, in a way, Gary thinks things are free will in that you have to aggressor intent and actually perform ontologically expressions that will influence other people. Where in my world, you know, he can't do that 24/7, I can't do anything 24/7 except for breathe and fucking metabolize, right? But I can't speak, I can't do that. And then this brings you to ontology, right? Now this is where Rorschach and I kind of agree, I think, in a weird way. Maybe it's not that weird. I gotta say, Jesus. Okay, but the idea of ontology, right? You are what you are. You do what you do. You express what you... You move through time once in a particular fashion, right? And so what I've been thinking of is is this, quite frankly. You get people that are vocal, right? Like, their ontology is fluttering this current shit. That's how they move through space and time, right? Is by barking, rip, yip, 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 which is different than somebody that takes the hands by the hand and moves shit from one place to the other. Puts food in poor people's mouths that gives currency to other people that have lesser currency or more currency. There's an ontology of isness that is the doing, which to me echoes what is most real about a person other than what barks out their yap hole, including me. Right, here I am, ontologically, I'm drinking beer. Conceptually, I'm criticizing things that are non-ontological. And now this is the crux, right? Not only is valuation of value changes the value in my knowledge of how things work. Just try it. Like, okay, think of a duck. Now, of a pink duck. Bingo! Something is so valuably different than what it was before. A pink duck is not just a duck. Right? You have changed it. You have altered it. It has affected the data stream. Right? The same thing with actual, like, ouchie. And I know a lot of you are like, no, but my organism is so caught up in its way that it's not actually a fake. Right. And I'm not saying that your organism is not repeating the same, yeah. I'm just saying this thing up here goes infinitely possibility outward forever into different dimensions that this, is not the center of the universe, even if it means your death. Even though it means you're dead. I'm not saying you won't have an agonizing death. I'm not saying you can't have an agonizing death. I'm just trying to say the power of the central processing unit, the C platform, apparently defines what's going on. Now, maybe I'm an abnormality, right? Maybe I am. Maybe the normal zeitgeist and paradigm and hell perception is that everything has to be in binary evaluation and that we should respond to anything that is on the bottom side of that value domination. And that this is just kind of a normative, and we know it, and hence let's build our ethics off of that. Well, fuck all you guys. Fuck you guys in the future or right now who think that if something, like the song, my head's underwater, but I'm breathing fine, right? Which I think is a response to the lady's song about, you know, like, you've put my head underwater. I forget the name, sorry. I'm getting abstract. Okay. Anyway, where was I? I'm trying to clip through these ideas to get to not value, but the idea that the very premise a philosophy for me, how I approach it, what I think is important. I'm not even going to use the word value. What I think is important is not just consideration, right? Consideration. But it's a there's a dismantling of, and I guess this is where I always come from, and why I'm anti-natalist. Any platform that tries to reduce what is important to all humans, to all beings, to all conscious communicative beings, which I guess is limited to humans, right, unless you're all dolphin speak, and I like to speak with mice in sign language. everything that is human is far more robust, more grand, more interactive, more possible than restricting everything to this pain, bad, like complete collapse, right? Like you can get mortar between the bricks there. You can squeeze a little juice in there and expand it. You can get a deflated balloon and inflate it between the bricks. You can lift a fucking building. People can move buildings, right? They can move buildings by inserting little balloons and inflating them between these little notions of what is fixed, right? And I'm just saying, like, for so long I've been so, like trying to cater and treat to this absurd premise, right? When I internally, experientially know there's more than all this. Not only is there more in the universe, right, that is unexplained, there's quote-unquote super fucking natural, right? So fuck you guys that don't believe in supernatural, right? I'm not saying that. Okay, I take that back. I love you guys. You're pragmatists. You haven't experienced anything out of the ordinary. But if you're going to judge people that have, then fuck you, right? Fuck you and fuck off, because fuck you and fuck off. You've got a limited standard that you think science has wrapped itself around, right? Just because science controls, there are things that science cannot, there's phenomena that science cannot, number one, and this is really easy, right, cannot control, hence there is no control experiment, yet the phenomenon occurs, it occurs, but you can't control it, hence if there's no control, you can't compare within, then you have no science in the scientific method. So my point is whatever. If you haven't experienced it, you're either not open, or I'm sorry it just hasn't happened, or the destiny of your soul is to live in pragmatics. Period. This is the destiny of your soul. It's all you'll ever know. It's all you'll ever live within. And I love, like my dad, right? I love my dad. I love my mom. My mom's a little bit Catholic, believes in God. My dad doesn't. He's a pragmatic atheist. He believes in science, and yet he is incredible, right? So that's what I mean by fuck off, but don't fuck off. Fuck off because you're judging and limiting other people's experiences and perspectives and considerations. That's why you fuck off. You're okay because you don't know anything other than the confines of your universe. And Grant, I am an older man, right? And it took me years to go along with it. Now, when I'm sitting at the bar with Chris, and he's talking about these phenomena that are happening when he was a child, like 6, 7, 10, right? Things he can't explain, right? That, to me, is amazing. Right, he's experiencing this at that age, and he's reconsidering it now. But he's pragmatized his life, which I agree. That's what I was going to mention. Right, even with spiritual enlightenment, ascension, and then recollapse, and realizing you're a biological robot, and you're courageous, and you're free, and you're guided, and you're a pawn, but you're also here in whatever capacity this is, and whatever consideration this is. There's nothing wrong with internalizing and limiting your considerations at some point. Like, at some point, it's like a potato bug wrapping itself up in its shield, right? It's like, lose your ego, and then when you land, put up a protective shield and use that as, like, ego squared. You don't really believe it, but it functions. It's functional, right? Like, believing instead of, like, I have a supernatural power of connecting with you psychologically, psychically, without the internet, without wires, and blah, blah, blah.
right? I can believe that and say, well, it's ancient, or I can say I can't, right? So I'll choose to believe that I must use the internet technology and the computer sitting on my lap and your computer and the internet to convey my ramble to you. Anyway, so I guess what I was trying to say is that even amongst all of this outwardness, and the reason I brought up the Mormonism earlier, was that everything is real, right? This notion, if you believe that everything you see and hear, including my voice, including the text, including the TV, including the radio, including the internet, including every sign and symbol is meant not just benignly passing by in some lateral drift in front of you, but is meant and pointing to you. It is meaning something to you. And to me, it won't always do that. But when you fall into an opening, first of all, everything is real, right? And then you absorb the collapse of all data, and you take every, like the song says, God, why am I so shit with songs? Okay, sorry. Well, how pretentious can I sound? There's a song that says, it's like, everything I used to say, everything that I used to know has gone out the window. Right? When you take that song seriously, right, and you literally black hole, gravity inhaling, or neutron star explosion. Black hole or neutron star. You take everything that you know and you believe, every paradigm, every thought, everything, and then you let it go out the window. It's gone. It is fucking gone, right? And you are left with nothing but a blank slate of pure, non-dualistic data impressions. And that is your soul, right? That is your being as a witness to this universe, minus everything that you're taught, absorbing everything that you know with focal points. And then you line up the accents, like a drum. You only hear the drum when the stick is hitting the drum head. Tap. Tap, 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 tap. You don't hear it when it's lifted. You hear it when it hits. So the same thing in your universe, right? When you see a sign, or you hear a word, or you make a lyric, or something is meaningful, it's kind of like your focal point with your eyes, right? You have a focus, and it's very narrow. And the focus is still there, but it increases in periphery and fuzziness, and it's out of focus, right? So it's that narrow part. Same thing with sound, same thing with media, same thing with symbols, same thing with data. You follow these data sets that trigger in your mind. Like, my mom said that I was thinking about my mom's or my friend or the TV. And what you do is you listen to the drum beat of your psychology as it moves through all symbols and all data and all media, right? And this is for the spiritually blind. These are for the people who have not been to the fifth dimension, right? If you're caught in the third looking dimension and you're trying to get to the fourth, oh, I got calculus and I got time, then you need to look back. You can't get to the fifth dimension until you look back at the second dimension. By second dimension, I mean you flatten everything. You lose everything, then you flatten everything. My hand here is no closer to you than this hand. This hand might appear closer, but just freeze frame it, blink fast, and just shrink it, right? It's just a two-dimensional palette, right? It's just a two-dimensional palette. Everything is a two-dimensional palette. Sound is more voluminous, right? Right? It echoes behind you. But now think of the quantum mechanics and Schrodinger's cat and the collapsing universe. And if you don't witness it, if you can't see it, it's in flux. Everything behind my head, right? The door's behind me. I can see it here, right? It's behind me. Now, there's a belief that if you can't witness it in your consciousness, until you do witness it, it is in waveform.
right? Now, Gary Mosher might fight this and say blah, blah, blah. And in a constant, pragmatic, grounded universe, which I happen to subscribe to generally because it helps keep my psychology together, I think everything is the case and that the internalization of other minds, other spirits, other you beings, human beings, living in your biological human computers, machines, BIOS machines, whatever, whether you're fucking it up with smoking and drinking and bad and black, getting healthy and not joining my goddamn isagenix company. whatever. The thing is that there's the possible consideration, once again, solipsism squared, that you are not, there's nothing there quantumly unless you observe it. Right, and that you are in like a form of a holodeck. If you haven't seen the movie The Signal, I highly recommend it. It's very excellent. You know, even in my most radicalized state, I learned this from chronic pain. Right, you crush your bone, you break some bones, and then in an instant. You're sober. You are so dead sober. And it's the same thing with alcohol, same thing with drugs, same thing with coke, marijuana, alcohol, methamphetamine, anything that you take. If you reach a certain threshold, not of use, not of abuse, but a certain focus, a certain concentration, a certain intensity of seriousness, you are not drunk, you are not high, you are not anything. You are dead spot on to what your being is. Kind of like in Birdman, right? Ed Norton is talking to what's your nuts and saying, hey, no amount of alcohol or marijuana is going to blur your soul's brilliance, right? In that same manner, to condense that soul's brilliance into what it is to be a psyche is to know that all of this alcohol, this consideration, this dialogue is dead serious. It's present. It's ontological. It's happening. It's recording. It's present. It's what I want to say. It is what I am saying, whether I want to say it or not. Okay, but. But yet, let's further this, and then I forget, of course, where I wanted to go. I don't know, I think I've glanced, like skipping a stone on a lake, I think I've glanced the major points. I'm not certain what to say other than, you know, somehow I feel like there is a centrific retardation of a lot of voices that are become centrific around the anti-nihilist community and I'm guilty of that. You know, in lieu of other considerations, have tended to make dialogue about that. And now I want to transitorily waft through it with dialogue. But when I think about energy and the fact that light is here and that images are here and that my biological being is here within this complex of other objects and acknowledging or believing in or constricting my belief within what other people say is space or outwardly or politics or, you know, space and politics become, you know, I'm talking like the difference between the Earth and the Moon, that space, right, which I said earlier was in the gate of black force that allowed photons through it, and politics as being equal to one another. Right, in that they're both as not important to my dynamic phenomenological life, right? My considerations. They're not. They're equal in that they are as non-important to my empirical existence and being as the other. And yet some are brought in. Think about what you bring into, you parse into, you allow into your psyche, being the very choice of your being. Everything is a choice. Me drinking is a choice. Me making a video is a choice. You listening to the video is a choice. I believe that even with my enlightenment and the grounding, even though at one point I believed that my mind was completely transparent to everybody and that I was just a free-floating soul in this universe, I realized that there is a vulnerability to every other independent entity out there, kind of like a free radical that is in shape of an octagon in its geometry, right? And let's say one out of eight of its positions is vulnerability, and the rest of them are highly protected. But the vulnerability is something there, right? So I was on Tinder, and I went out on this date, and she catfished me, right? She only had headshots, and I showed up, and she's huge, this huge, huge lady, right? It's not the first time. And I'm not just there to piss them away or to be superficial. I want her to engage, but she was obviously self-conscious about her weight and blah, blah, blah. Anyway, we got to talking about her weight. We got to talking about all sorts of stuff. But it was bumping into somebody else's vulnerability, obfuscated on media, but presented in empirical, in life, and she was weirded by it, but my point is that it seems as if everybody has a vulnerability, right? Kind of like, okay, now Gary Mosher argued the argument, which means that if I were to say, if I were trying to speak, that my argument was about the ontology of how humans actually behaved in the universe, right? And that some people have a yap-yap vocal cord, and they yap-yap, and they make arguments. But that mine was more like, what is this entity doing in space-time? And that is where I preface my argument. I feel as if not only am I more robust and grander and kind of underlying like antinatalist sitting on a trampoline, and that I am the trampoline pushing upward, downward, moving, wafting in some sort of like Einsteinian relative gravity space-time, saying, look at what you are saying, please, look at it. Look at how it echoes outwardly in the universe, how it relates to your identity and yourself and your consideration. Look at how it echoes in what you principally believe is not only truth but the case, and then consider what a truth capture device is, consider binary valuation, consider what I've mentioned about the transposition of valuation onto values and how that affects values, consider letting go of everything that you've thought, everything that you believed, consider believing more so in the weirdness that has once happened, which you cannot explain, which allows this mortar between bricks to expand into this nativity of what is cosmic in the universe, what is actually maybe possible and greater, like the internet itself, greater as this hyper AI intelligence that God himself is manifest in Google, right? Now, granted, if we experience a technology that's greater than our understanding, we believe that it's magic. Now, that, to me, is kind of
not dislike Google in that I can't wrap myself around all that it knows and all the programmers that have networked everything together and come up with this great goddamn weird-ass thing called the Internet. But when you look at it, is I am existing from point A, the dawn and dilation and horizon of my very birth, as I've moved through time, into the present, into the future, and that somewhere along that time, the advent of microwaves in my life. Microwaves, the space shuttle, the cell phone, the Internet, and the AI of the Internet, and the, everything that is known, and full disclosure, and blah, 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 and the networks, and the networks, and the communication, blah, 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 that is has punified us, subjugated us, moved us in this way. And I'm not saying that we won't redominate or connect with it and overthrow our perception of it, and some people may have. My point is that the fact that this creature, right, this guy, this me, this dude, is living in this time of knowing pre, during, and current knowledge of programming assets that goes beyond my scope of consideration, right? Like, I can say I understand the pragmatics of programming and justify the Internet, but what the Internet expresses and what it does to me still is so confounding, it feels like fucking magic. It feels like magic. So either I am just naive, right, which I'm not, and the Internet has nothing to do with the orb and nothing to do with my red star, nothing to do with my Jacob's ladder, nothing to do with my good, nothing to do with anything that is spiritual or supernatural. It's not discluded from it, but it's not included in it, but the mere fact that my existence from the dawn and horizon of my being as it's moving through time and will fall or infinitely re-engage, whatever this is an odd phenomena. I don't know quite how to explain it, and I speculate about it, and it opens up future possibility unlike anything I've ever known. It just does. It just fucking does. And I think it does to you too, right? I think if you're locked in any strict, conviction, not only about who you are and what you are and what you think and who you think you are and who you think you associate with and the impact of your being, if you have any beliefs about any of those things, including your very identity and your very sanity and your very metaphors, if you believe in all of it, any of it, if you're convicted to it, then you're an underling, because you've internalized a truth capture. Look, I have an old friend named Scott, right? Scott Justison. Now, this fucker misguided me in life on trust, and then I learned to resent him later on because of a previous decision, right? Anyway. He's an airline, right? Not an airline guy, but he flies planes out of Alaska and went into the military, even though he hates the military, right? So talk about, like, negation. Fuck this dude. But he's an okay guy. But fuck him. He steered me wrong. He borrowed my trust. He bent me backwards and ruined my own sense of lex naturalis or positivity through life. In any case, this is how and whom. And perhaps it was a godsend, and I just don't see it as such, but I do see it as such, right, that I turned out the way that I am. So that being said, I'm saying anytime that there's this notion, this internal pointing of either A, truth, B, identity, C, cause and effect, D, what is the case, and that's the most lax and elastic of these considerations, right? It's still there's more to consider, right? That goes on the exterior of whatever you're internalizing. And that exterior, as much as you try to find an external bound to it, you're not gonna find it, because it goes infinitely, you're infinitely more naive than the AI, the artificial intelligence, the Google, the knowledge about it. You are infinitely more naive than the collective. But here we are. We're like bored, but we're federation, but we're bored, but we're federation, but we're bored. We're subjects, we're pawns, we're masters, we're gods, we're infinite, but we're finite. How does this all happen? How is this universe put together? Can you interpret the wind outside? Can you interpret your cat's meow as a spiritual being? Can you interpret something that you've never believed before? And why? Not only is it fun and creative and considerate of you to do so, it will blow your mind and whatever extracurricular re-ego satisfaction and settlement that you've ever believed about yourself away again. It's like, not only does the caterpillar turn into a butterfly, but the butterfly turns into a goddamn eagle, which turns into a goddamn jet plane, which turns into a satellite, which turns into a starship, which turns into something. It's like this infinite re-explode. Like, Dolly had it right, right? He had a little egg, and out of it was a fish, and out of it was a tiger, and now the tiger is on me, right? It's just this where aesthetics and consideration of concepts ultimately dominate the day, I think, right? And then what are the limits of that as opposed to orchestrated, industrialized, computerized, concrete, you know, scientific number factoids and so forth? Who knows? And how is the internet guided by my interaction with it? How reflective and responsive is it? I don't know. I think it's fully responsive. It's almost either I've chosen a weird path in the video game of life, or, and I'm using just the metaphor, right, video game of life, but wait, it seems concurrent with the current idea, blah, blah, or it's all, like, just in order. Everything's in order, and it's not to be concerned over. And I guess that's what I'll end with, is even with considerations, throwing everything out the window, exploding it outward, losing your ego, losing, you know, opening yourself up to possibility, there is still, to get along in this universe, like to own oneself as an internalized and externalized biological creature, right? Just the fact that we have skin means our minds make a metaphor to an outward limit that is the skin. So no matter how outwardly you are, we have a tendency to skin it. Like in video game programming, you build the model, you build the skeleton, you build everything, and then you skin it, and then you build the muscles and the tension and stuff. But you skin it is the point. The limit. I'm not saying it doesn't extend. I'm not saying it's not rubbery. I'm not saying it can't go everywhere. I'm not saying anything. I'm just saying conventionally, traditionally, we limit it. So even after enlightenment, like after enlightenment, before enlightenment, you go to the river and wash the clothes. After the enlightenment, you fucking go crazy, and then you go to the river and you wash the clothes. So, what am I saying? It's an hour and a half. Anyway, I like, genuinely, the people, whether holographic or not, and I know you're not. You're independent, internalized other entities. I believe that now, right? I've reduced that now. Right. And everything seems to be like this matter of reduction, but the path traveled has shown me greater possibility than anything or anybody that I've heard online. Now, I I'm not trying to be an ass. I mean, everything everybody says is influential and dynamic and seems to cover a greater ground of perspective, like a tine stretching out from my little universe, right? But when there's a cohesive, eccentric positioning that doesn't allow for its own undermining, otherly consideration, period. Otherly thought, otherly notions. Then, kind of like this, kind of like, right, the world is spherical, right? We tend to believe that as opposed to the flat earths. But okay, so as opposed to the spherical world, I said we live in a spiral universe, a spiral world. And the reason I said that is because we're in an orbit around a sun and we're spiraling in a verbous, not just nounous, you know, time-oriented corkscrew throughout the universe, and that our very being is the corkscrew, hence we're spiralic and not to just be looked at as this spherical gravitational thingy, right? Which I'm extending consideration of the world, of the earth, of things to be looked at in terms of time, because it's never, and they will never be, in apparently, if you believe in the cosmic explanation of how space works, it will never actually be in the same time, in the same place. It's infinitely only once, hence such is our lives, infinitely only once. This is like Anton. Oh, Anton, you big fucking dullard piece of shit. We were so great. It is a one-time occurring event, such as life. This drinking, this YouTube video, this expression, this utterly, what I think is an okay expression, right, to grant towards the future, is dandy. But it's once, right? I will never say this thing in this order again. And this notion of, you know, if you took a million chimps and you gave them typewriters, they would eventually type the words of Shakespeare in an infinite amount of time. I don't actually know if I believe that. Maybe there's only a once Shakespeare, and there's never, ever, 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 ever any such a thing as a duplicate, even in an infinite universe. I don't know if I buy that either. Anyway, the point is, it seems to me like things could go any way, either way. It seems to me that people's arguments make a sense here as you internalize them and then condense them. And then when you rotate and you outwardly position and point, and reconsider and throw in the ignorance factor and the naivety factor and the all that I don't know and all that I can inflate factor, and then it's not the same. And it's just a matter of turning the head. It's a matter of this to this. That's it. And this reliance on mere formatic argumentation overlooks the meaning structure that comes not only from fiction, but comes from reconsideration and dilation and reword formatting, then these constructive attitudes. Like there's constructivism, and there's deconstructivism, and there's reconstructivism, and when you reconstruct you're re-approaching, but you're reconstructing, re-deconstructionism, right? Who's come up with that term? Re-deconstructionism is the pull away after the, like, I'm a solipsist. Wait, I can't move my hand there. Wait, I still am, I'm a solipsist square, and then you re-deconstruct it. Oh, wait, now I'm still the same, solipsism cubed. And then you release, you let go of the arrows of internalization, you grant outwardly, you grant other minds, you grant too many minds, you grant infinite, not only word constructions, but the possibility, the very possibility that any construction of lingual connection, the mere fact
platonically, hypothetically, teleologically, actually in the verbis of expression, has an echo, a dynamic, a vibration that may or may not abide by any previously here paradynamic notions of what constructed point of view could possibly be, right? Funny thing, yeah, Joe Rogan, man, that fucker, he copied the topics of Louis C.K. in his 2015 stand-up comedy act. Very, very disappointing. Going back in time, going back to Hitler. It was kind of abuse on like five levels. And so he's a mockingbird, right? He's mocking. And I know what mocking is, and I know what parroting is. I know it so well that when I see it in other people, I'm fucking disgusted by it. That's why this clandestine cult behind reiterating Benatar, Gary, and in this fashion is like this, like, oh my God, not only am I so familiar with the attitude about it, it's so stupidly argued and it's not creative and it's not original, it's just reiterative and reinforced, and there's a contempt. I have a contempt for it because I have a contempt towards my past where I did such things. Okay. Where am I at? 138? I don't know. All I know is, man, I am such a minor player on YouTube, and I wish I was super famous, but you know the fucked up thing about philosophy and YouTube, right? Is that only the concentrated, kind of like juice can be concentrated, only the concentrated mind that finds virtue in being a concentrated mind falls into positive valuation about philosophy. It's not science, it's not computer science, it's not anything, it's not ethics, and it's really not value. It's a habit of perhaps safety, right? Like a lot of people find safety in their notions of their intellect. Their notion, like, I have read a lot, I am very well read, or I have learned a lot of math, or I know about ethics, or I know about programming and structures, or I know about how I think I feel, and it aligns, right? It's like this, I don't know, it's I default to quest for community, right? Quest for relation. I default to that. But when I think about it, like on an individual node level, like why are all these nodes falling into this, right? Because there's quite a few, you know, but it's such a small little droplet of humanity's thoughts on things and cares and joys and things that It's so knotted and jagged and edgy, and you know, it's like a goddamn chess game, and it's got this fucking brilliant yeller attitude. Like I used to, when I'd play chess, right? If I knew that I was up against a formidable opponent, I would purposely move my pawn like left and right and then act dumb and then just upset the game and then say something a little awkward or a little sarcastic or yell or try to emphasize a characterization and impersonation of an actual piece or something like that to defer or to make psychological the game to disrupt the other. These were all attempts. They were like warlike fashion, right? All right, here we go. Shit. How long am I going to go? 2, 3. I'm only on my second beer, but I mean, after 3 glasses of wine, I need second beer. Why not? And I'm going to flush, man. I got to get up in the morning. Like, it is 2:20 a.m. I got to be up at 6:30 to go to the gym, to swim a half mile, lift a fuckload of weights, and then come home and prep Prince, and then maybe go out with this goofy lady, this really goofy, but kind of fun lady. And I think that's what I'm after. I think I like her already, because not only is she so not, like, weirdly, like, caught up in her shit, she's, like, she's free and goofy and light, and there's just something so lovely about that. It's not, there's nothing pretentious, there's nothing she's, like, there's no agenda. There's got to be some underlying pre-functional composition to her being. But it's more of what she's putting forth that I'm like, I'm caught up in octopus waves with her, right? And it feels lovely. It's like a soft, happy massage. But back to what I was saying. What was I saying? Who the fuck knows? I don't know. I should just end this shit. This is too long. You guys have been listening for so long. I mean, I appreciate it. I appreciate, like what I imagine, like, there's people that comment occasionally. There's people that I know. There's people that I interact with. But it's actually you silent viewers, the ones that have rarely or never interacted with me, but still watch my shit, right? You watch what I say. And somehow you will watch it again, because no matter whether I'm way off conceptually or what you would say, kind of like Rorschach or Ludite Return, that dude, by the way, just for the record, right? I'm a painter, and that swell dude, that cool dude, that other anti-antinatalist like me, you know, he might pin himself as not an anti-antinatalist, but I like that term, anti, right, edge. Anyway, he, years ago, bought every print that I've ever produced, and I sent it off to him, right, and he took it all, and then he got back to me on some of the edgier religious prints. And we talked a little bit about it, but we haven't really got into it. But the thing is that not only is he a literature absorber, a philosophical investigator, but he is an art appreciator and lover, and he's a father and a nurse, and his care seems to be not only investigative, but open and grounded in procedure. Right? His actual behavior in life is one of caring for, granted for money, granted for his own well-being, granted, yeah, I'm not doing that. But yeah, I gotta give him props. And I do. And someone like Trick, right, I gotta give Trick props for always being there, but the thing about Trick is that Trick believes what he says, right? The very fact that somebody believes in what they say, like if I had to be convicted to not reapproaching and reconsidering everything I've said in this video, if I had to be convicted of that, in not only a one fashion, but in a reiterative, absolute, self-convincing, ego-fed, yoke-feeling, yellow, feel my yoke, fuck me right here, again and again and again and again, this is the case, sort of truth capture, it must be sort of self-satisfaction, I'd be tricked, right? But I mean, that is his yoke, that is being, that's where he comes from. And what do you expect from other human beings? I mean, what do we expect? Like, maybe he's expounded and then he's condensed, like I say, spiritually, and then I've condensed and I know my skin and I internalize it. Maybe that's all it is. And where I empathize with the antinatalist is in kind of like, okay, just like ape out. quit getting spiritual, quit getting metaphysical, quit getting super, just ape out. Think of your ape being in skin, ouchy bad, blowjob good, cotton candy good, pin in palm bad, right? Like just please just kind of like wax her and just note that. And then don't go off on any of these tangents or these reconsiderations. But if I personally have to condense myself, I personally, through my tragic, bone-crushing, back-breaking, fucking feet-smashing, cigarette-burning, drug-using, fucking abandoned love, abandoned career, abandoned life, self-cynical, reiterative, I'm more gifted than talented sort of attitude towards life. When I think of my being at this middle age, right, and everything I've gone through, then I personally, like Trick, like these other condensing sort of reiterative truth capture, like it must be the case, there's no way to negotiate or reconsider or navigate sort of attitudes about value versus valuation or binary value systems in general. When I think about that, I personally realize that there is mortar between bricks, there is space to expand, there is reconsideration, there is another thank you very much for watching my movie, another thought that by being a thought, the virtue of by being a thought, not only transposes, interludes, intersects, interjects, sets in motion, sets between, expands out, expands through and throughout, that the very act of having a thought opposed to sensing a data stream, because I'm sensing all my data streams, right? And apparently I'm in a homeostatic scene where everything's balanced and I'm drinking alcohol, which causes this physiological upset or change. In any case, not only can I re-soberize and become like dead if I'm willing to do so, but in a time of complete, utter, the completeness of everything you've ever known as utter pain hits you, right? And maybe it's just because I was abrupt. Maybe it's a punctuated pain that I'm responsive to, but a slow catastrophe, even though I know slow, dilated, long-term chronic pain, I know that, right, like cancer. I know it in bone-crushing, bodily melding, back synapses hell, right? I know it. In that, I didn't live only ever in that. Okay, sorry guys. Fuck, man, it's 1:47:58. I appreciate anybody that's listening this long, I really do. I mean, thanks for giving me kudos and listening to my horse shit. But it's like a goddamn movie, right? You can watch whatever you want to watch. Now, for those of you who find any value in what I'm saying, I am not really saying anything that I've ever said. But I do look back on my videos and my attempts to, like, recategorize, make centrific an orbit around, to expound my spiritual notions. I'm heavily influenced by everything everybody says. But as far as complete abject negation and notions that A, I'm a dipshit, or B, I'm not considering something that must absolutely gravitational be considered, like gravity, well, fuck gravity then. Fuck gravity. I've already gone against gravity. But even if I have to reconsider gravity, which I will, and then I love gravity, and I bond with gravity, and I have skin and internal vision, even if I think all that, and sorry that I'm really drunk, and then I'm kind of blah, 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 blah. Getting agreement, right, like the majority of argumentation appears to me to be about trying to substantiate agreement in order to make steps towards grounding a conclusion. Like, we've anchored an agreement here, therefore, et cetera, leads to this conclusion. And et cetera, is the chain from the anchor that leads to the boat. And the goal of the philosopher, the argumentative philosopher, is not only to anchor an agreement, but to go chink by chink all the way up to the boat and say, this is the boat and this is where it's at. Well, that boat can float anywhere on the goddamn ocean. The anchor is not static. The chains can break. They can inflate. They can deflate. Okay. Now, I don't even care why I'm saying that. I don't really care about that. So what is it about care and value, right? Now, Vic is interesting. I like Vic's approach. He doesn't believe that anyone would go against lex naturalis or do anything against themselves. And I say, and what I was telling Chris tonight at the bar is, no, you can know what is best and then choose to negate it and not follow it and do something entirely different than what you believe is your righteous, rightful, intuitive purpose, right? Now, a lot of people just get online and bark, blah, 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 like Gary will bark, and some people want to bark, and they want to bark, but when you look at the ontology of their life, right, like, oh, I get up in a shit shack, and I go clean a pool only in the summer, and then I whine about my cats, and I spend my money on computers, and where did I get my money? Well, maybe from government, because I'm incapable of being on... employed, so the government gives me money and then some on welfare, and I can't say that I don't relate to that. I do partially relate to that. But at the same time, what I'm saying is the ontology, the fact, the isness of someone's presence should, in my philosophical value opinion, dominate over whatever is coming out of their mouth. How do we evaluate that? Well, we have to use epistemology to ground ontology, or ontology to ground epistemology. You have to say something, so you're using epistemology to ground ontology, but it's really the focus on the ontology, and that's the value. And I'm not trying to degrade someone else's opinion. I'm not really trying to degrade that. I'm just stating that anybody that tries to ground an absolute in my quantum relative reconsiderative possible acceptance of naivety and the confounding abysmal robustness of this naivety towards the universe. Someone that's not aware of that, or denies it, or tries to collapse it, or concentrate it, or reduce it, fuck them. That's what I say. And this has to do with religion. This has to do with antinatalism. This has to do with rationalism. This has to do with gravity. This has to do with fucking Neil deGrasse Tyson. This has to do with anybody else. Anybody else that is not thinking the way that you want to have the universe think, fuck them. Okay. Well, with that being said, I wanted to reach 2 hours. So, okay, now I have like 6 minutes, roughly, 6.5 minutes. Let me try to get this all done in under 6 minutes. Here, I better drink. Watch my cool, smooth Bud Light commercial. That's ripe old age of whatever you think I am. I'd like to be considered younger sometimes, but sometimes I just happen to look old and baggy and wrinkly. Oh yes, Keystone Light. Praise to you. You're getting a fucking kudos on my YouTube channel. And you're not even paying me. Maybe when I get to 10 billion views on this video, just this video, not 10 billion subscribers, 10 billion views, Keystone, out of the blue, will just hand me, like, a check for $57.86. And I will be a happy man. Because I can retire on that shit, and you guys don't even know. But in the future, shit gets so bad that you can, via the internet, hire
East Indian people to give away and enslave their lives for about 2 cents on the dollar. And I'm looking forward to that day. Not really. Wow! Politics, world, like, okay, when you recondense, when you regroup, when you reconsider, when you get in your own skin and you're not spiritual, and yet you're the God and politics is all meant to be, and you've ostracized political parties, you don't have any variance, like I said, politics and space are equivalent, it's all this absenting of importance. Then you regroup, you revalue, you reassess, you recenter, you refocus, and then you can reevaluate politics. Like, this is what's happening relative to my being. This is what's happening relative to my sense of currency. Am I egalitarian, or is everything hierarchical? Is my currency hierarchical? Should I get into a hierarchical field? I don't know. Should I actually be utilizing other people's resources, or even if they're naive, or should I just agree with their naivety and their egalitarian share and work labor, or should I benefit? Should I not benefit? Would that make me a bad person? Should I? Are rich people worse than poor people? Are hungry people better than satisfied people? Who is what? How is this? Who is this universe? Am I more enlightened? Am I less enlightened? Am I better? Am I worse? Am I heavy? Anyway, that's why I had a beer. Maybe I wouldn't be back on YouTube. Maybe I wouldn't have a goddamn rant to rant had I not had a beer. Right? Anyway, I have a cat, right? In my proximity, in my physical proximity, the care that I have is mostly the affections needed by my cat and my relationship with the cat. This is the barren loneliness. Now, some might not believe this, right? In life, now, provided you do grant a godliness, or even if you don't grant a godliness, but provided that you don't grant a godliness and there's still a godliness, right? A control and your subject is a pawn. Well, kind of like in Goodwill Hunting. This woman shows up as an angel in your life that God sent here just for you, right? Now, if you believe that you are an angel and that they're an angel and that somehow God is correlating something positive, and then you take God's blessings, be it food that you don't pray over, be it a woman or a man or a loved one that shows up and you fuck them off, you piss them away, you let them go, you let love go. You let it go. You've taken one of your master, your dominant, your peripheral extensions of AI God or whatever this universe is that brought that other spiritual bodily entity into your existence, and you did not love it, bond it, cling to it, but instead you deferred it, pissed it away, argued against it, and you utterly let it go out of your existence and your future. Well, then, you're not only talking to me, you're talking to Gary Mosier. That's right, that fucker, sad as he may seem, pissed away love, then utilizes his dying cancer sister as reason to hate on not only humanity and everybody else. He needs everybody, but he's got to piss everybody off, right? Now, that's what you have to agree to. Like, I'm going into this to get hated on. I'm going into this to get ridiculed, right? But now the thing is, now I did that in love, right? I had the blessing of an angel a few times. And I ultimately still pray. I didn't used to because I was an atheist. But now, even though I don't think, I kind of believe in the Jim Morrison, you cannot appeal to God, but you can still speak outwardly, openly, outwardly, in a prayer fashion, right? To bring the possibility of a new angel, a new love, a new possibility, something positive that is not a self-deprecating, like,
let me smoke my life and drink my life and become lax and lazical and whine about life. Let me get rid of whining, smoking. Granted, drinking is, you know, thanks, I love burning. Sorry, I'm not going to finish this up in 2 hours. It's going to go like 2 hours and 5-10 minutes. Anyway. If, but like this other angel guy that showed up on Venice Boardwalk when I was painting down there, and he's 10 years my younger, and he started doing abstracts when I was doing realism, and he was wowing people and making headway, and then he went to Sweden and married a woman and had two kids and moved to Tennessee, and he's 34 now, and he's kind of broke and not certain what to do with his art or himself or whatnot, but he's a great guy, right? But one thing he wrote on his profile was always believe that something is about to happen to you that is amazing, right? Always believe that. And when I read that, and I knew it came from him because I know the guy, because they became my roommate, and we fucking drugged up hard, we partied hard, we fought hard, and this was all in my negation of my puppy love, reiterative cyclical love that I got pregnant and she got an abortion and I came back to Utah and then went back to LA and blah 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 blah, 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 and worked at eBay. I think there's a song in here, blah blah blah. Anyway, he was great, and when I read that and I thought about it and I thought, I'm hearing that, I am listening to that structure of words, and I believe in that. Like, and I'm not all about blowing smoke up people's ass and everything all positivity. Like, I've negated the positivity, which maybe I shouldn't have negated the positivity. But I realize if there is a master controller and my mind is a prism and my consciousness is being fed, then everything that I'm saying and everything that I'm doing is really not for me to blame or own, but I gotta own it all, so I'm owning it all. So be it, take it as it will. Anyway, when I read this point about him being positive and thinking something amazing was going to happen, then I thought, even after tragic love, kind of like hypothetically speaking, if Gary Mosier got on a video and just said, look, I not only am I so sorry for hurting anybody else in any way that I have, I am so desperate to be in love with somebody, even those who have loved me and I've negated them. Like, would you please, if through all of my anger and hell and pain, if you felt as if you could love me and be with me, and you know that I've interacted with you and felt the same, would you please contact me? Would you please? Would you? Pretty please. I'm certain he would get somebody, right? But the thing about somebody that moves away from love, that chooses away from love, not unlike myself, chooses against the blessings of their very being. And I'm sorry to use like corny terms like blessings of their being, but shit happens, right? And it moves through the ages and the times of your life and the ages of your life. And if you don't buy it, then listen to more Fleetwood Mac, okay? Just listen to some Fleetwood Mac, right? But, you know, this can be forever or it can go down in flames, as Taylor Swift would say, right? So, try to know that clinging, that internalizing, that post-apocalyptic philosophy and self-apocalypse and Muslim jihad of the psyche that leads one to ascension and virgin, 72 virgins. To me, to make a metaphor to justify Muslimism, is 72 virgins are aspects of your life that you have not only let go of, but they are remaining benign and untouched, and you have access to infiltrate them with love or with abuse in any way, and that after your enlightenment, you roughly have 72 untouched aspects of your being. And granted, this is heaven. Now, between now, after enlightenment, and when you die, you have these 72, and by die, I mean biological death, not spiritual death, which occurs earlier. Anyway, that to me is what the enlightenment is. Now, I'm not trying to disfigure or make radically unliteral religious phenomena, because who knows? Who really knows? I don't. Even though I say and I claim to supernatural experience and interaction and engagement and knowledge of, I do not know what all of it meant, nor can I say this is the case, right? Anyway, okay. Now, I gotta pee. Alright, I think I can win this on a piss. Who wants to pee? You want to piss? This like piss? You want to see me pee what I've consumed in the... I won't go full. I'll leave you guys to be. I've enjoyed the rant, and if you have any questions, if you want to join Isagenix, or you want to buy a piece of my art, Mike Fail Art on Instagram, FAHL, on Instagram. I just started it, got 30 subscribers. Feel pretty good about it. You know, 930 subscribers. Mike Fail Art. I think it's all one string. FAHL. Follow me there. Facebook, you'd have to search Mike Fail, FAHL Art, on Facebook, and hopefully it shows up. I got a painting on the movie Salt Lake City Punk 2, by the way. It hasn't come out yet. SLC Punk 2 or Punk 2, Punk is Dead. One of the paintings in the background. That's why I keep it on my art page. I've been waiting for it to come out. Anyway, check it out. And yes, I like alcohol. And no, I don't smoke weed anymore, cigarettes. And I really gotta pee. If anything that I've said, right, rings a bell, notes you, entices you, pisses you off, does anything to you in any emotional or intellectual fashion, please, just don't be afraid and just type a little comment about what you think about, because then I'll know who you are and you can expose yourself finally to the rigors of the actual internet and make an experimental thing. And then I will, let's say, thank you or engage you in some capacity. Anyway, really got to pee. Don't want to take you to it. Goodbye. Have a good night and thanks. Bye. Oh, shit. It's still recording.